food system specialist for FAO, will talk to us about multi-stakeholder platforms as a best practice for supporting sustainable agriculture in fragile ecosystems.
Oh, good afternoon, everyone. I do realize it is only me that is keeping you away from the wine and drinks after, so I'll try to be as brief as possible. Also, we're a bit running. First of all, I'll present myself. My name is Federico MATTEI. As mentioned, I work for the Mountain Partnership, which is an FAO institution. We work mostly with mountain agriculture, also with through the GLISPA, which is the Global Island and Fragile Ecosystem Partnership, also on coastlands and deltas and these kind of things. And I have to say that last week or a couple of weeks ago, when my office told me I had to come here, I was initially not skeptical, but initially confused. And I thought, why would the theoretical physicist be having an event on sustainable food systems? And then one of the first things I did was to Google the definition of physics. And apparently it is a branch of science that deals with how the fundamental constituents of the universe interact, with interact being the main word there. And also listening this morning to some of the speeches when we were talking about the sustainability of everything, I did realize, and in fact, physicists might be the most pertinent to talk about the complexity that we are facing, because you're one of the few or one of the few people who are specifically interested in looking at the minuscule, so how things interact at a very, very small level, but then how these things interact in the complexity of something very huge. And this is exactly the challenge that we need to face. And I think so it is very pertinent that you're having this discussion. I was then surprised, I have to say, during this day, because I had taken a few notes of what I was going to say, and I kept noticing that everyone was making my points. So I had to change my thing every time. So I'm like, okay, I'll talk about...
That's the problem of speaking last.
Exactly. So about, you know, externalities and about the complexity and about so many things. So I had to keep changing my thing. Multi-stakeholder platforms, I will say something about this. And I think this is a multi-stakeholder platform. There is nothing new about this. And I think there is a kind of change in the last decades, in the last years, of bringing together all the different stakeholders in food systems to a table and trying to define programs, projects, and how to implement them together. There is a word coined, I think, by Slow Food, if I'm not mistaken, which is the co-producer. So it is the act of bringing consumers into the discussion of production methods as though they were co-producers, because it is through their consumption patterns that they really create and define production practices. And maybe this could also be used in a way for science. I think science is neither bad nor good inherently. It is a tool. Sometimes we really need to understand how the science, or what the objective of these scientific instruments and tools, what are the objectives. And I think by bringing in the people who then are going to use these scientific tools into the discussion as early as possible, we can kind of co-create scientific approaches, tools, and methodologies. So maybe co-scientists could be the term you could take from this. That was mentioned this morning, which I would like to touch upon, is the price versus the cost of food. And I think this is a very, very crucial point. I am an economist, unfortunately, so I tend to think in economic terms. And one of the first things I learned as a young man studying economics was externalities. Externalities, I won't go into too much detail of the economic theory, because it's apart from the fact it's economics 101, but you can find it quite easily on the internet. But it's really when we do a price cost function, some of the benefits or some of the costs of any single economic operation are external to the actor who does this. Let me make a specific example so you might find it easier to understand. If I have to build cars, I will look at per unit cost. What is my cost of production? So the materials, the steel, the workers, and so forth, the electricity, and obviously how much I can sell those cars for. I will come to an equilibrium. So if I produce enough cars, I will be able to break even and get enough profit. The problem is that a lot of the costs and sometimes the benefits are externalized. And so when we look at things like pollution in the sense of the cars, the pollution, the serious the negative effects on the population, these are not borne by the car producer, but rather by the collective. Someone today mentioned that no one is paying for these external costs, but in fact, everyone is paying for them to a varying degree. And so one of the things we need to understand is that when we go into a supermarket, a shop or whatever it is, and we see the price of the food, the price is what we see on the label, that is not the real cost of the food. In most cases, there is a cost which is much superior to that price. This cost can come from environmental degradation, from health, from social aspects, and so forth. Sometimes there is an extra benefit which is not part of that cost either. So if we look at some of the more, for example, I found it fascinating, Mr. Ely was talking about before regenerative agriculture. Some of the benefits of that regenerative agriculture are not included in that price. So, and I think economists and I think scientists in general really need to find ways to re-internalize these negative and positive externalities. And by including them in the price, then the consumer is able to make, let's say, informed or rather real decisions on what they want to do. I'm very much against dictating what people should buy or should not buy, how they want to spend their own money. But the price of those goods should respect or should reflect all the different externalities in that product. One thing I've noticed is there has been a lot of talk today about really kind of large scale agriculture. I found some of the presentations fascinating, especially the one I'm thinking of now is the one for Professor Basso. And I was trying to think, how could this be used? I am a farmer myself. I have a smallholder farm. How could I use this? And I thought, you know, it's kind of difficult. I couldn't get the magnitudes. And we have to kind of remember that depends how we consider a smallholder farmer, but anywhere between 30 and 80% of global food production comes from smallholder farms. 30 is if we consider them under 2 hectares, I think, but 2 hectares is a very small farm in many contexts. And something like 30% of the world's population is occupied, is employed in agriculture, directly or indirectly. So how do we then respond? And many of these, of course, are in smallholder farms, especially in the global south. And how do we use technology to also provide them benefits and to really tailor the technology to their specific situations? I think this is a challenge for the future. So, for example, when today agriculture has been very much defined as a source of CO2, we've looked a bit less as agriculture as a source of livelihoods and how many people worldwide depend on agriculture. One of the things that I think science can be very, very useful in this respect is one of the main disadvantages of smallholder farmers is the inability to have, for example, economies of scale. Obviously, if you have a very small farm, you won't have the money to buy certain kinds of machineries for transport, for stocking, and so forth. And traditionally, this has been in many ways not resolved, but through cooperatives. So putting a lot of smallholder farmers together, you can then have much more economies of scale. You can have investment opportunities and so forth. But maybe we can also see how science, specifically tailored science, can help those smallholder farmers and can maybe limit some of the disadvantages they have from a lesser economies of scale, lesser economies of scope. And I think we've come to a point where physics science is very mature in that respect, in which it can be tailored. Things like the Internet of Things, we've talked about them a bit today, and how can we make it a lot more flexible, a lot more pertinent for the smallholder farmer? When we were talking about multi-stakeholder platforms and in general science and scientific innovation, I think there's different ways that we need to then use this. So for example, we talked about a lot about environmental sustainability, a bit less about social sustainability. Health has been a very important topic. But we also have to see how, for example, we can really understand certain things. So we've talking about land use, for example, and how agriculture is always seen as degrading the quality of land. This is not necessarily true. We had a fascinating conversation at lunchtime about alpeggio. Alpeggio is is a practice, it's a cultural practice here in Italy where cows were brought up into the mountains in the Alps, especially during the summer months, and then brought back down to the villages in the winter. And this, the conversation we were having about this was how some scientists, or many scientists, seem to believe that this actually increases the biodiversity of these ecosystems, because through grazing, they open up meadows in what are fundamentally coniferous forests. And these meadows seem to have, after our conversation, higher biodiversity, both of plants and insects. There's more light coming in, there's more interaction. These kind of cultural practices can be important sources of regeneration. Same thing, for example, I spent quite a lot of time in the Philippines working with rice terraces up in the Cordillera province, and they have these terraces, and there's a whole cultural, a set of cultural norms associated to these kind of food systems, which are very important. So for example, one, you can imagine the management of the water. Obviously the person who has a farm on the top of, or a little plot on the top of the terrace, if he uses all the water, it will not be enough to come to the lower levels. This causes social tension. And so there's cultural norms which have been present for generations, which manage and which monitor the use of this water. Another example is, for example, when a daughter is married, the family of the daughter plants 10 trees up above the rice paddies. And these are clearly attempts to avoid soil erosion, because obviously if you deforest the part of land just above the rice terraces, leave it one generation or two and it all comes down. Another, for example, link between, and I think this is very important, that food is very different to other things for a number of, or for two fundamental reasons. One is culture. And so we've touched upon it a bit now. Another example, which is more of a local example, has to do with pellagra. Pellagra is a disease that was prevalent in 1800 up until the 1800s. And it was a vitamin deficiency, which was very prevalent here in what was before the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, but the Italian part. And it arose because when corn was brought from the New World to the Old World, it proved extremely beneficial for food security, for yields, for income. It was massively planted here in the Padanian Plains, in the Po Valley. But one of the cultural norms associated with it was not brought to Europe, which was nixtamalización, which was a way of cutting the carbohydrates so that they were then accessible by our human body. And this caused pellagra. And it took them quite a long time to realize that pellagra, this debilitating disease, was not some kind of airborne virus or something in the water, but it was a nutritional deficiency. And this nutritional deficiency came from a lack of cultural understanding of the crop. This obviously is no longer pertinent, and it shows you how sometimes we try to detach food and especially the genetics of plants from these cultural norms, and sometimes we cause problems, let's say. The other one, and I've promised I was going to be as brief as possible, and so I will shut up in a few seconds, is that food is desire. And this is something even less, it's even more not understood by scientists. I worked for quite a long time for the CGIAR, which is a very scientific-based institution. And then I moved to Slow Food, which was an NGO working in a very, very different way. And I realized that one of the things I did learn about in Slow Food was that food is passion, food is desire, food is taste. And we tend to forget this. And so, for example, you know, when we go to, I myself sometimes go and eat fast food or drink a Coca-Cola, and just the pleasure it gives you, the sugar, the chemicals inside, makes it harder for you to make a rational decision, which is very different from most products. In the same way, food is linked to culture, food is linked to conviviality. We tend to eat together. There tends to be traditions, social traditions, on how we eat and what we eat. And so the last thing I'll say is, one of the first speakers today, I think it was Dr. Sergo, talked about Michael Pollan and The Omnivorous Dilemma, which I think is a wonderful book. I've actually based one of my farm on one of the farms in the book. But I would like to mention another book by Pollan, which is The Botany of Desire, which is a much less known book by Pollan, but I think is just as worthwhile, especially for people who are very scientifically approached, because it shows you all the different links between these four different agricultural products. I think it's apple to potatoes and another two, about the link between foods, desire, and culture, and pleasure, and these kind of things. And I think in such a scientific environment, I wanted to add this, because maybe I can add it and others can't, to always remember that food is very, very much linked to pleasure, to desire, to conviviality, to culture. And without taking into consideration these aspects, it is very hard to then change consumer behavior. The last thing I want to say is, though I do think consumers and working with consumers, or consumers, have a very, very large responsibility in how the food system is shaped, I think the responsibility of sustainability cannot be left 100% in the hands of consumers. And there has to be policy, there has to be a legislative environment that allows consumers to make the right choices or points them into the right direction. And so I do think that, for example, once we are able to measure externalities, we need to re-internalize them through prices, things like subsidies. We need to subsidize positive externalities. We need to tax negative externalities, because we need to create a level playing field. When we go to the supermarket and see those two prices, and see the price of, for example, traditional Filipino terraced rice and imported GMO rice from Thailand, it's not the fact that it's GMO is the problem. It's the fact that we, the consumer, does not really understand that price differential, what it entails. And for example, one thing that's quite useful, which quite a lot of different institutions have been using right now, is tourism. And so bringing consumers to the productive places to see the farms, to talk to the farmers, to eat with them. And they kind of understand a lot more what they are subsidizing with that different price. So they understand that those ecosystems, those farms, those people, because we often forget that there's people, there's literally, 30% of the world's population working in agriculture. And sure, we can maximize yields, we can create economies of scale, but then we have to find something for these people to do. So I think there is a balance. Of course, we don't want an inefficient food system just to keep people occupied, but we need to take into consideration these billions of people that work in smallholder farm and provide solutions for them. We do not have to go back in time. There is, the anti-science is one of the worst case scenarios for the future. Even worse would be going back to some sort of idyllic past, which doesn't exist, or maybe it did exist before agriculture, when we were still hunter gatherers. But since then, it hasn't existed. We need to move forward. We need to leverage science, and we need to count on scientists more than politicians in guiding us. But the science has to be targeted to provide solutions for the smallholder farmers, for the consumers, for the companies, for the private companies, rather than for those huge, huge, for the large multinationals, or rather for those who have money, enough money to spend on research. So there's a lot of people that cannot do research. And I think it is the responsibility of science to also find solutions for them. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'll start with one question about FAO views. I mean, one of the things that we hear a lot lately are these big programs to reforestate the planet, the 1,000 billion trees that was pushed forward by the G20 initiative. And I was at an international meeting in Rome at the Accademia dei Lincei, where this topic was discussed. And one of the issues was, if we reforested in Europe, that will involve a very small surface. The real problem is to reforestate in Latin America, for example. And the issue was, who is going to tell the farmer that his land is no longer going to be farmland and that it will become a forest? And who is going to compensate him for the lost income?
That is a very good question. I sometimes think I have a farm in central Italy, and sometimes when they talk about reforestation, it's, we planted, half a million trees. And I always think to myself, who's going to water them? Who's going to take care of them until they actually live? Because, anyone who has planted trees, not in Alaska or, in places where there is a lot of water, knows that if you don't take care of trees, they'll die very quickly. I think that's there's two different approaches to this. One is what you were saying, we need to reforest this, we need to create this as a kind of a green lung, and so we need to move people out of it. And the another one is trying to find solutions which have a space for all of these stakeholders. And so, for example, we were talking about coffee before. Shaded coffee is a very good example of this, forested coffee. We can choose between coffee, which is grown in monocrop, in fields with no trees, with no forest, but coffee as a plant is a forest product, comes from this forest plant. And so by working with coffee producers in ensuring, A, they don't cut down forests to plant higher yields coffee, or if they already have those higher yield coffees, how can they can transition back to forest agriculture, to shaded kind of coffees, is an example of how you can sequester carbon, recreate forests without negatively affecting the producer. If anything, we can, if we also manage to then trigger a price premium on his coffee because it is forested coffee, then the producer is even happier because he has a more fortified livelihood. FAO in general, I think, is a very, seen from inside rather than from seen from outside, is very heterogeneous. So there's a lot of different thoughts in FAO. I think FAO recently has taken more of this approach, but I think inside there's a lot of different voices, and sometimes it's hard to understand what these voices are and who the people you can talk to these things are about.
I have a question about prices. Because it's in theory, it's very tempting, the idea of internalizing of taking externalities into account when making the prices of things. But just imagine how difficult it is. Who decide about these prices? How do you protect the system of pricing from lobbying from all sides? How it can distort the markets, because prices are an essential signal in the economy. You're an economist. And how would you, for example, handle situations such as the one that was mentioned by Michele this morning about animal husbandry being six times more efficient in an intensive way than in Africa? So how do you value all these competing interests? I think it's fascinating, but incredibly impractical, I'm afraid.
Up to a certain point.
Do you have an authority, an all-powerful authority?
That doesn't have to be. I think you're looking at it as a kind of a truth which comes down from God, and we need to find that. So that's not exactly what I'm talking about. It's more trying to understand what I talk to a lot about with is government officials, so ministers. And I look at, but unfortunately, they're the ones that tend to create a legislative environment. And they tend to think the cheaper the food is in supermarkets, the happier my people will be. It's a question of food security. We don't want people starving. We don't want people wanting malnutrition. And so when we talk about the sustainability of food, prices go up. And so they're afraid of not having enough food for everyone. No. However, if they then go, look, how much are you spending on your medical bills, so on the medical industry, to solve all those problems that cheap food is creating? When you're surviving mostly on high fructose corn syrup as a source of calories, and then you're spending a huge amount of money for obesity, for childhood obesity, for these kind of things, you're paying a lot more. When then your Ministry of Environment comes in and says, look, we are losing quite a lot of money every year due to deforestation, due to soil erosion and so forth. All of these things need to be put together. So the decision cannot be taken only by looking at how can I get cheap food for my people? For your question is, how do we determine this? Is what I ask you. No, this is what I. What is that?
The amount of litigation that would.
No, it's. I mean, it's. You can look at it right now on the Common Agricultural Policy. There is quite a bit of subsidies for sustainable agricultural policies. Who decides how many? What are those subsidies? Who decides who gets them? A group of panels, a group of experts. It is the policy makers that decide these. We will never arrive at a true price of something, but we cannot just avoid the question because we are scared of getting precise measurements. Look at, for example, the tax on carbonated drinks in Mexico. Okay, we don't know if that tax is exactly equivalent to the negative externalities due to those carbonated drinks. We do know there is a huge problem of obesity in Mexico. We do know that that obesity problem is, at least to a point, linked to an inadequate nutrition and an excessive use of carbonated sugary drinks. So by taxing those, we reduce the consumption of them. And so we reduce the negative externalities. That's why I need theoretical physicists like you, which are used to looking at the complexity of the universe and telling me this is how we should do it. I can identify there is a problem and that we need to move into that direction. I don't have the expertise, of course, to determine exactly what that price is. This I need to ask people like you, people who are used to measuring complexity and who are used to doing an analysis which has, because the problem, it is complex, it has so many different factors which affect that price that we can, as you said, if we only look at a certain of them, we risk being unfair. Because as they were saying before, you know, the organic farm might be more biodiverse. It might have a better use of certain resources, but then it might have certain disadvantages. So is it just because it's organic we pay more? No, it's much more complex. That I agree with. And that is the difficulty we are facing.
Before we move on to the next question, I just want to remind you that our latest Nobel Prize winner for physics, Giorgio Parisi, won his Nobel Prize for research on complex systems. So you see, and he's a theoretical physicist.
Okay, thank you, sir. I'm looking at water financing for a smallholder farming, and it is a big problem for a dry region like Africa, since Africa is one of the dry continents. So what modalities is the FAO taking regarding water financing for small-scale farmer, because that comes with a huge loan. And the majority of the small-scale farmer do not have that money. So what are you people doing? Thank you.
Well, first of all, once again, it's very hard for me to speak for all of FAO, because you can imagine it's a very complex institution. What I can say from my personal point of view is, for example, one of the uses of technology, the kind of use for technology which I think would be very useful for smallholder farmers, is this kind of thing. So using, for example, precision GPS technology to put water exactly where it's needed. If you look at most of the irrigation in farm systems, is wasted. And you can see this driving up and down the Po Valley, fields and fields of tomatoes. And I saw them in July and August of this year, when in Italy we had a huge drought, spraying water up into there. How much of that water is going to hit the ground? When it hits the ground with 40 degrees, we're talking about, you know, I saw them do it at midday in July. How much of that water is going to the plants? 10%, 5%? I have no idea. So if you're using, for example, I think the Israelis developed a lot of these kind of techniques because of the kind of you know, desert agriculture they sometimes have to do. If you're managed to put that exact water on exactly that plant you need, your cost for that water is much less. And so someone like a smallholder farmer can access some certain things. You can use a lot less resources in a much more efficient way. So technology can help you being more efficient. And this is extremely important for a smallholder farmer.
Yeah, I think if I can make a comment, that the same concept applies also for the use of plant protection products.
Yeah.
If you have adequate modeling of pathogen populations coupled with analysis of precipitations, you can time the application of plant protection products much better and greatly decrease their utilization. And I think this goes to the advantage of smallholder farmers if you set up a system where this information becomes available to everybody and not just to the big farmers that can afford to use those fancier models.
Exactly. Or for example, I have I'm an olive farmer on my free time when I'm not at FAO, and I see there that when the fly, the olive fly comes, you need to treat it either biologically, whatever, but you never know when it's there. And when you do realize it's there, at least me from a farmer point of view, it's kind of too late. And so most people will spray regardless of whether there is a fly or not. Already a system which can be used by a smallholder farmer, which tells me, yes, the fly has arrived. And yes, there's the pheromone traps, there's things like this, but trying to push more into that makes, then I can spray when there is a problem. And it's the same thing as the antibiotic resistance we were talking about before. You give antibiotics to livestock when there is a problem, not in general. I'll give it to you because I don't care if there is a problem. And it's that same kind of logic. It's trying to bring big, big systems, big technological innovation to a very kind of personal small level, which can be used by the Ethiopian farmer, by the herder up in the Andes, or even by myself, for example, because I'm a smallholder farmer.
And that calls for a lot of training and retraining of these farmers because they do not understand these.
Yes.
You have to bring it down to a level they can take it in and apply it.
Yes,
yeah, but for the scientists, we can always do it.
Yes, so, education and raising awareness, let's say, are key. There is no innovation without, or you cannot spread innovation without then raising awareness and building capacity on how to use this innovation.
Thanks a lot. I think we have come to the end of a very interesting day. Thanks to everybody, to the speakers that gave excellent presentations, as well as to the attendees who were very participative in asking questions. And remember, if you want to take a copy of the book, we have now the cocktail drinks. And see you tomorrow morning at 9 sharp. We'll start to talk about nutrition, diets, and health.